Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the weekly show with Aditya, India's number one podcast, with India's number one host, Aditya, in association with Dusra.net, the number one website in sports, education, and entertainment. Which team will have the last laugh in this World Cup? Going by the performances so far, no team has had a perfect World Cup. Means no team is going to get a 10 out of 10. We can divide the categories into good, bad, and average. The teams with the good performances include, with a rating of 9 on 10, these would be India and New Zealand. Some of you may be surprised. New Zealand has lost the last few matches and India just lost the match versus England yesterday, and I still put them in the category of good. When I say a team does good, means a team has done good. Moving on to the average performances, that is a rating of 8.5 out of 10. I would add England, Australia and Afghanistan in this category. Now, why Afghanistan when they have lost all of their matches? Well, for me, winning or losing wasn't the criteria. Australia and England, despite being the most overhyped of the teams, have had an average performance. Yes, they might make it to the semi-finals. In fact, Australia has already cemented its place in the semi-finals, but they have chinks in their armor. They have their weaknesses, and good teams are going to exploit that. Yes, New Zealand and England did not exploit that, but if these teams get a chance again, they will not let that opportunity go by. So yes, Australia remains in the average category. As to England, well, they have been good, but they need to improve their performances. Yes, they beat India by a margin of 30 runs. And yes, their openers did the job. But apart from them and Ben Stokes and for a little while the captain, nobody has been able to step up as far as the batting goes. And like England, every team depends on the 4 or 5 individuals. So, yes, England have to improve in a few areas. They did lose to Australia in the last match. And for a team which should have been in the semi-finals a long time ago, they are struggling to reach over there, and then they have to put in desperate efforts. And now they are clinging on to that fourth position. As for the bad performances, or we could call it the semi-average performances, I would put Sri Lanka, South Africa, West Indies, Bangladesh and Pakistan. Now people would ask me, why Bangladesh and Pakistan in the semi-average? That is a 7 on 10 performance. Well, despite their efforts to go into the finals, the two teams haven't done what they should have done. While these ratings are subjective, the human mind wants this. Means without giving a mathematical component to everything, we the humans only substantiate everything if such ratings are given. This question is for the audience. Which of these teams can win the World Cup? Your options are A. India, B. New Zealand, C. Australia, D. England, E. Pakistan, and F. Yes, this is a surprise. F. Bangladesh. So please send your answers to my email ID and then we shall discuss this further on the 15th of July 2019. Now let's get to the India-England match. As has been the norm, everybody's favorite whipping boy is MS Dhoni again. In a world where we are obsessed by strike rates and other technical abnormalities, the very people who are questioning his approach as to whether he should have accelerated and he could have lost the match by a slightly lesser margin, let's say 10 to 15 runs, and the fact that the entire planet used or abused Twitter, a platform whose credentials are questionable in itself. Probably if this application was available 15 to 20 years ago, would they have done the same thing to other individuals also? Well, we won't know, since this application wasn't there 15 to 20 years ago. Forget the people on Twitter, because they are not to be taken seriously. But without naming a few so-called experts, and I won't name them because I don't want to endorse them, but those who understand will understand which individuals am I talking about now. And if the same individuals who are questioning his tactic of not scoring runs or being unable to accelerate were there today batting well, let me tell you, they would have done the same thing but not taking any undue risks. A couple of them have never even played a World Cup, and then they question that, why is this happening? Why is this individual not doing what he is supposed to do? In fact, I would question Rohit and Kohli's tactics in the first 10 overs. They could have taken a leaf out of Bairstow and Roy's book, just gone for the shots without even thinking of the results. And look what happened with those two. They just hit every ball, and some of them did not go for a six, but majority of did. So that is what Kohli and Rohit should have done. Let's move on to the positives from this match. The bowling was top class. I'm talking about India's bowling. That bowling was top class despite the spinners going for runs. And recall, why did Kuldeep and Chahal come into the team? They came into the team because the all-rounders in Ashwin and Jadeja went for runs in the Champions Trophy final. This is what happened 2 years ago, and this is what they were hoping to avoid with the leg spinners. But the spinners go for runs. That is a very common theme. The three fast bowlers in Pandya, Shami and Bumrah bowled beautifully. Everyone in the team got a chance to bat. And despite the negative atmosphere being created, for me it's better than not chasing 230 and 290, which the England team failed to do. Despite Rahul not living up to the expectations, I am still not missing Shikhar Dhawan in the team. For the next match, we can slot in Jadeja and Kartik in place of Kuldeep and Jadhav. And the next match being against Bangladesh, they, like little kids, are going to bring up their match against India in the 2007 World Cup. Why? Because they beat us. And they will never stop talking about it. And ironically, two out of the three experts were part of that team, and then they questioned the tactics of the team today. But including Kartik means three wicket keepers in the same team. That would give nightmares to a few people. So if not Kartik, my changes would be, and they have to make the changes would be Jadeja and Shankar in place of Jadhav and Kuldeep. That means the batting lineup also becomes better. Not playing Jadhav would be unfair, but didn't England drop Moeen Ali and get in Plunkett? Why not have four fast bowlers in Bumrah, Shami, Shankar and Hardik Pandya along with Jadeja and Chahal as your spinners? In fact, my suggestion is disregard things like power plays, field restrictions and get Jadeja to open the bowling and surprise everybody. Irrespective of a fact that a left arm spinner should not bowl to a right hand or a left hand batsman when there are fielding restrictions. For me, such restrictions are nothing more than superstitions. And if you win the game against Bangladesh, then your semi-final position is sealed. And for the last match against Sri Lanka, you can bring in Dinesh Karthik. The 11 players I just announced who could play against Bangladesh, they may or may not. But the perfect team that I've announced, that's even better than the team Australia has. Stoinis and Maxwell have not been impressive as far as this World Cup has gone. They're forcing Steve Smith to go at number 4 when he is a better number 3 batsman like Virat Kohli and the others, and they are forcefully putting Khwaja in the team. Either this guy opens or he is out, but then Australia doesn't have a good enough number 4 batsman, so they have to slot him in forcefully, while India has good enough number 4 batsman, so they don't have to worry about who comes in at what position. So when India defended 270 against West Indies, it was called poor batting. But when Australia defended 240 plus against New Zealand, it was called great batting. Why? Because they were 90 for 5 and they somehow crawled their way up to 240. So if you want to continue this debate about middle orders, then neither of the 6 teams who are now vying for the top 4 positions have an impressive number 4, 5, 6, 7. In fact, if you look at the teams, only 3 of them have got good enough fast bowling all-rounders. India has 2 in Pandya and Shankar. New Zealand has 2 in Grandhomme and Jimmy Neesham. While England has 2 in Ben Stokes and Chris Wokes. While the remaining 3 teams in Australia, Pakistan and Bangladesh do not have a good fast bowling all-rounder. And yes, I do not count Marcus Stoinis in my book. Stoinis is good, but his contributions have been nil. As far as the other all-rounder in the Australian team goes, that is Glenn Maxwell. Well, this guy is all hype and no substance. Remaining 2 teams in Bangladesh and Pakistan, well, they do have good spinning all-rounders, but they have a lot of way to go. They need to improve further. If we go further into this, the all-rounders of the tournament in my book are, irrespective of fast bowling or spinning, at the top position is Ben Stokes, followed by Pandya at number 2. Number 3 is shared by Neesham and Grandhomme. Number 4 belongs to Shakib. Number 5 is Morris and Fekloweyo from South Africa. And number 6 is Mohammad Nabi from Afghanistan. At number 7 is Dhananjay De Silva from Sri Lanka. If we look at the captain of the tournament so far, yes, I'm talking about the captain of the tournament so far, irrespective of who goes on to win the World Cup. It was a tough choice as we have so many potential candidates. At number 1 is Kane Williamson from New Zealand, followed by Kohli at number 2. Owen Morgan at number 3 and a big surprise of Faf du Plessis at number 4, despite his team South Africa not making it to the knockout stages. At number 5 would be the captain from Afghanistan, Gulbuddin Nayyab, despite his team also not qualifying for the semi-finals. The captains of the other 5 teams did a decent job, but these 5 were good, and yes, I included 2 teams who have been knocked out, because we cannot evaluate a team by its performances or by that team making it to the knockout stages. That is never the criteria. That is always a good effort, but that is never the criteria. Over the last 19 years, India has been led by three great captains and a half captain. The first one will always be Sourav Ganguly. Why? Because under him, we dispelled of the theory tigers at home and lambs abroad. Though I never agree with such phrases, we should never use them. The captains before Ganguly were mediocre, below average, and tactically weak. Because under Ganguly, Dravid and Tendulkar could play with more freedom. And in the 2003 World Cup, we made it to the finals. The result of the same notwithstanding. After Ganguly, we had a few interim captains before Dhoni took over, and the rest is history. Post Dhoni, we have Kohli, and he has been a good captain. Yes, you can question his tactics at some point in time, but overall, in my book, he will get 9.5 out of 10. And when I give such ratings, they are to be taken seriously. No other team sport has the captain as an active stakeholder. You will not see the captain anywhere in football or hockey or even basketball. Unlike cricket, where 11 people play selfishly for their own gain, and if the team wins, it is out of sheer coincidence. And that is why we are reacting so wildly when Kohli has not scored a century in this tournament. In fact, he has scored 5 50s and people still are not satisfied. And the term hunger we use in this sport, well, that term is just a buffer for the actual term, that is selfishness. Because if this was a team game, then you would have had the concept of substitutes like we do in other sports, which are actual team games. I hope you enjoyed this episode on the 1st of July 2019. So if you want to be a part of my show, please send your valuable suggestions and send your recordings on topics ranging from sports, education and entertainment on the email ID adityathewriter@gmail.com. That is adityathewriter@gmail.com. Thank you for listening to this episode. Please like and subscribe to my Facebook page and YouTube channel, and stay tuned for the next episode.